It bonds somewhat to the pipe, but depending on if you've got an old clay line and if there's a lot of scale in it, it may or may not bond, it may bond to the scale, but most of that gets cleaned out when you do it. You don't want to go in and overclean a line because you could cause that clay to collapse. And, you know, a lot of those lines are cracked or fractured starting out. You know, you don't know that you have a bad line until somebody drives into a sinkhole. That's the biggest, one of the biggest issues that we see. This actually increases the flow capacity. So the sewage actually moves better through the pipe because it's a PVC pipe than a clay pipe with all the joints and the humps and the joint separation. It reduces maintenance. And again, like I showed Mike today, we had very minimal traffic disruption. If we would have had to excavate that line, cut it open, excavate, tear it out, haul off all the debris, put a new pipe in, do all the bypass pumping and everything, it'd probably be about a 3-day job. And it's driven a lot by the weather. I mean, we don't work in pouring rain, storm, things like that. I mean, it gets a little dangerous sometimes. But each one of these crews are about 6 to 7 men. Again, maybe, you know, 2,500 to 3,000 feet a week. The key is to stay out of the way. This just talks about the envelope, 6 to 108 inches. The thickness is a quarter inch. On an 8-inch, just rule of thumb, 6 to 8-inch, you get 6 millimeters is what that line of thickness is. And that's about a quarter of an inch. And we can go up to about 2.5 inches thick, which is a pretty solid hunk of plastic. Don't drop that on anything. That came off a large diameter. What happens is we can go around bends. We can do offset joints where the pipe is actually separated and it's not aligned truly. If we can get a TV camera in there and clean it and TV it, we can line it. What will happen is the liner will have it'll hold the form and then it'll go where you have a constriction, then it'll open back up. So you still have the constriction, it's not going to jack it up or move anything internally. We're putting, I have about 15 PSI pressure internally into that. So we're not exploding the pipe or degrading anything. We're just holding it up against the sidewall until we cure it out. And we can go lengths, this says over 2,000 feet. If it's a straight run, you got good conditions, and it's a small diameter. The trick is, and we ran into this on a Kansas Department of Transportation project. It was a 72-inch diameter line, and it was 435 feet long. And what we do is we were considered vertically integrated. I'm an engineer, so I don't really know what that means. But we manufacture these felt tubes in Mississippi. Our wet-out facility is in Indianapolis. So they take this dry tube, and it comes out flat. They ship it to Indianapolis and they saturate this with a polyester resin. It's a wet plastic. And then it goes into a refrigerated truck because to go from the wet plastic tube to the finished product, it exothermes. So you have to have heat to set off the catalyst and it cures or it bakes. Okay, an 8-inch line, 300 feet takes an hour. Rule of thumb. We saw today this tube came out, it was 350 feet, it was 18-inch diameter, I think it was 7.5 mil. And our engineers calculated if we're going to steam cure it, it was 2 hours, if we're going to water cure it, it was 2.5 hours. So they know, I mean, they follow that chart, and they know what they're doing. So it's relatively standardized. Again, we manufacture our own tube. We can add reinforcing fibers. We use that a lot on the storm side and some of the bigger diameters, where it takes this and you don't have to have as many layers of felt. So you can have a thinner liner, but then it's reinforced with fiber. And therefore, it takes less resin, therefore it's less expensive. So it's kind of a trade-off. We'll look at it both ways. Our standard is our polyester resin, which is good for sewer and storm. Sometimes we get into situations where there'll be some chemicals or hydrocarbons in the ground, and we'll go with the vinyl ester resin or epoxy resin. When you go up, obviously, it gets, the epoxy is about four times the cost liquid resin as the polyester. And here's just a picture of the I-plus composite, which shows the fiber reinforcing. We clean TV these lines before we go in. Typically, we'll go in and clean and TV a line about 2 weeks before we come out and line it, because we want to see what this looks like, and we have crews that just stay about a week to 2 weeks out ahead of our lining guys. And what they do is they look at the video, they locate where the services are at. You can see the service on the left side. Okay, but they also look at the condition of that. If there's big chunks missing, they'll say, hey, wait a second, we want to go with a thicker liner here. Or we need a port repair. We need to have an excavated repair to get this line open because it's not open. So we make that assessment, then we verify the diameter, then we verify the length, because each one of these tubes is custom made. It's not like a lot of people say it comes out of a truck on guttering and you just cut off what you want. But we looked at the line we had today. It's pretty specific. What the location was, what the job number was, who the superintendent was going to install it, when it was wet out, when it had the resins injected into it. So it has a shelf life as long as it stays cold. But we felt it, and it was relatively ice cold. It's got to stay cold to stay liquid. So we make an assessment, and typically, a lot of people say, like, if it's an 8-inch line, the standard liner is 6 mil, but you can go up to 7.5 mil, and you can go 9 mil, which is, you know, you're adding 150%. But a lot of times, and you can go on our website, and our website has a spreadsheet. You can go and you can calculate the diameter, or you can calculate the liner thickness based on the depth. You know, how far you are below the ground, if you've got inflow and infiltration, which everybody has that problem. And typically, we're back at the standard. I mean, we did some that, I mean, I looked at and said, oh, we've got to go with a thicker liner here because it's underneath the railroad. Well, it comes out 5 mil thick, and so we can go with a 6 mil liner. So it typically comes out that way. Again, you know, we talked about, I like this statement. The pipe assessment takes a lot of engineering subjectivity and judgment. We heard that already tonight. So, okay, and you know, you really, you're being over conservative. If you know, you got to look at it. If you're going to say this pipe is fully deteriorated, it must be grossly misshaped, large sections missing, which happens a lot, or future loads expected to increase. We're working with Black and Beach in Kansas City on a big detention basin that they're working on, and they're going to add 20 feet of fill over this existing sewer, and they want to line it. So we're looking at a couple different options on lining. They don't want to dig it up. So we're looking at our standard liners, and we're looking at that I-plus composite. And we're doing the engineering for Black and Beach and telling them what this liner needs to be based on the loads that they're telling us. So if their loads are correct, I mean, we're right on. And then they can do an engineering study and tell the owner it's going to cost this much. This is how we're going to do it. Any questions? This is just some hocus pocus stuff here, just some engineering. This shows basically the kind of the loads you look at. Obviously, you have soil load on top of that pipe, but then you have groundwater loads, and you look at your ground. The ground pressure or the water pressures are radial, so it's pretty much equal around the circumference. But you know, we run into problems sometimes where you have these ionized, you get these leaks. We manufacture our own tube. Here's a couple installations.